Okay, everyone, I'm here with Jimbob Isaac, former Taint and Heart guitarist, but you may also know him from his other work doing graphic design for bands as well, album artwork, beer labels, all sorts of stuff. Jim, you're a busy man.
Hey man, good to see you. Thanks. Yes, always spinning many plates. That's how I roll.
Yeah, absolutely. We should say this is a bit of a rerun of the interview that we did at ArcTangent. Unfortunately, the audio didn't come out very well. So we were meant to have this chat on the air quite a while ago. So it's a long time coming.
It's nice to be able to do it in the comfort of our studios, our workspaces.
Absolutely, absolutely. What we're mainly here to talk about today is your new project. I just gave that list of things that you normally do, but you've got this new project, Silverburn, and the debut album, I should say, Self-Induced Transcendental Annihilation. An absolute mouthful, but a great title. Let's talk about the project in general first. And when we were exchanging messages like this, you alluded to there being quite a story behind the name of the band. I don't normally ask this question, but it sounds like there's something to talk about there.
I think it's always nice to be able to communicate to people why you've picked a certain kind of a moniker, I've not been asked it, so it's nice to be checked in with that. So, Silverburn, it's a nod to the kind of era of bands that have influenced the music on one hand. You've got bands like Bloodlet or Dead Guy. I wanted to, I kind of enjoyed the whole thing of going for a double-barreled one-word name, if you see what I mean. And also, kind of that elemental, even spiritual-based imagery and connotations with the silver and the fire aspect. So it ties in very intrinsically with the lyrical and energetic content that's gone into this album. So yeah, and
It kind
I
of gives
like.
the feel of kind of forging something precious as well, to me. The silver bird, it kind of gives that connotation.
Exactly. All of those things tied together.
Well, the project's an interesting one. You've played a few live shows now, you've got a backing band there, but the project very much started out you doing everything. And by everything, we mean everything as well. Why don't you tell us the story behind, putting the album together, the approach you took to it as well? We'll come on to the sounds and themes in a little while, but the process itself is quite interesting.
Sure. Well, it's a solo album. It's a real deal solo album. I wrote and played and performed every single instrument on it. In fact, making it a band was very much a secondary decision, and it actually took quite a lot of energy and trust for me to even consider making it a live band. I made the album for me. It was sparked off, within the COVID environment, the lockdown environment. It grew and grew and expanded as a project, and given the climate, as I say, of lockdown in of itself, I was kind of prepared to just put it up online as a homemade digital home produced DIY album, but then it kind of grew and expanded, and a friend of mine who's a local sound engineer and actually like a college lecturer as well, he encouraged me to spend more time learning the physical drums for it to then record it properly to make it 100% legit, real deal album, which I'm very grateful to my friend. His name's Adam. Shout out Adam. Really grateful to him for giving me that little bit more impetus to do that. So
Yeah,
yeah, and
when you say about putting it out online just as something you've done, and then him encouraging you to actually learn and lay down the records, this is because you mapped it all out digitally first, didn't you? And you put the album together, and then went away and learned all the instruments to then record it properly afterwards.
So it's a case of like even in at the digital demo stage, the drums were still organically constructed. I mean, these days you can use loads of preset loops, and it sounds very convincing. Yet at the same time, you're kind of relying on another drummer's performances. I didn't use any kind of presets in that sense. I manually hand tapped all the drums in, and you know, you're kind of editing as you go along, but there was no sense of quantization or gridding or anything like that. So all of the drums in the demos essentially are the same as what I then performed physically, because I spent an entire year, weekend in, weekend out, practicing the drums. I bought my beautiful new drum kit to do it. So it was a labor of love in that sense as well, taking that drum kit to and from the rehearsal every weekend, very much like a chopping wood mentality. As I've said recently, you know, the attitude was like, yeah, if I don't chop some wood this weekend, I'm going to freeze. So if you see what I mean, like, you kind of like instill your own sense of ongoing accountability. And so, yeah, you know, hence why the drums on the record, they're real deal performed by me. And I spent a year playing along with the digital demos to be able to do that.
Do you know, I love that use of technology and how technology has got us there. You know, I think there's a lot of way that people use technology to cheat, you know, and you can often tell that. But this way, you can still create something in your bedroom, if that's what you want to do as yeah. a solo artist, but still get the feel and the rhythm of actually really playing the instruments and that. And I think that's amazing. That's a great, great leap in home recording, isn't it?
Yeah. It's, I mean, you know, I'm not sure if other people do it in exactly the same way that I've done it, because a lot of people do rely on the kind of preset loops and preset loops and whatnot. But I do have a drumming background to a certain level. And, you know, a huge reason of even doing this was to actually learn and improve more of my drumming, as well as more of the production side of things. Yeah, you know, it's like, as you said, it's about feel, and my drumming is feel based. My sense of songwriting is feel based. My guitar, you know, everything. I'm not like a machine metal type of guy, you know. I'll leave that to the fear factories of the world. You know, that's not me. So everything I do, I feel is based upon feel, you know?
Yeah. One of the things that I love about this is the amount of time that you spent, you know, learning all the parts once you kind of laid it down. You alluded to there, part of the reason behind that was wanting to kind of work on your drumming and improve that. What was that? What it was? Was it personal ambition, or was it filling spare time during lockdown, or a bit of both, maybe?
Oh no, it was this was a mission. This was like a committed. This was like going to war.
Really stretching yourself, really wanting to push those comfort zones.
Yeah, personal transformation, you know, and this kind of ties in with everything that led up to making this album, everything that led up, you know, in my own personal journey in these last few years. So it's like, yeah, on one hand, it's like a war. I've gone to war with this album, and crushing my enemies with it, you know, that's the attitude.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, the feel comes through that way. The sound is certainly the right kind of sound for that attitude as well, isn't it? You know, but you took 5 years away from music and doing a band. You talked there about stuff going on in your personal life and this album being a reflection of that and that attitude. What was there something that prompted you to come back to music then in that way? Was there something that you felt you needed to get out?
I didn't touch any instruments for 2.5 years from 2017 till, you know, halfway through 2019 into 20. I needed a whole bunch of time out at the end of my previous band Hark, and it was literally the COVID environment that kind of flick the switch in me, and largely thanks to Eloy Casagrande from Sepultura, the incredible drummer, who was sharing like jam clips. So I started doing some jam clips along with him for some fun, and started to realize that just how little I knew about home production software and whatnot. So big thanks to Eloy Casagrande in that sense as well. I actually had the pleasure of meeting him and the rest of Sepultura last year, and I got to tell him that. I did an official T-shirt design for the band, so I was able to meet those guys and tell him that he was the reason why I started making music again.
Oh, wow, amazing. Well, what was his reaction when you told him that?
He was super happy. He's like a really driven guy, and he was really glad to hear that.
So it sounds like you've gone through some real kind of learning curves with this project then, not just in terms of the musically, but the home production and stuff like that as well. But I get the impression that you thrive on that you thrive on pushing yourself forward and picking up new things.
Oh yeah, for sure. And like, I have to hold my hand up and say that for many years before that, I was a bit too lax in that general approach, and I had to admit that I was kind of behind the curve in lots of aspects of gear and tech and whatnot. So, you live by your mistakes, at least I do anyway.
Yeah, I mean, but there's only so many things you can keep on top of anyway, isn't there? That's the problem. It moves so quickly these days. You've got to be able to dedicate the time to it, don't you?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
We've talked very much about the mechanics of the project and the solo work you put into building it up. I thought let's talk about the actual music on the album now. You did allude to some of the influences on there, particularly, Sepultura pushing you on to actually start doing the home recording stuff. But musically, what kind of bands have you drawn influences on for this project?
I mean, there is definitely a little Sepultura flavor in there. It's all coming from the metal I grew up with in the 90s, as well as, very much heavily the early 2000s and the a lot of the Hydrahead and Relapse records bands. We're talking like, well, Victory Records to Revelation Records, a lot of the hardcore, metallic hardcore bands. You've got people like Dead Guy, Botch, Keelhaul, very underrated band, by the way.
Not one I'm familiar with. I'll check them out.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing. It's like a lot of people kind of are using, continue to use Mastodon as such a yardstick, and rightfully so in many ways. But at the same time, when I was first listening to Mastodon, I was listening to Botch and Keelhaul, and a lot of bands off escape artist records. You'd have like Playing Enemy, Anodyne, you'd have like bands like Coalesce. There's a lot of Coalesce energy in the Silverburn records. So as much as Mastodon sits in there for me as well, but it's nice to be able to help people know about all of these other bands and record labels who were just as important and influential as Mastodon, really. Not to take anything away from those guys either. I love Mastodon too, but
But it's the age old story, isn't it? There's always a band that kind of becomes the byword for a scene, and the rest of the bands, and there's all those below it that kind of don't get as much credit as they should do. So it's great to shout those out, absolutely. Just thinking about in terms of building the music and the sound, when you're working with a band in a studio or in a writing workshop, the sound kind of bounces off each other. You might play a riff, someone might play a drum roll, and it builds from there. But when you're building something solo, and particularly in the way that you've done it, did you have a sound in mind in your head that you were trying to capture, or were you just laying things down and then building on what came out?
I didn't have anything like preconceived. I mean, I put Annihilation down first, and I almost did it with a kind of, well, in such a no fucks attitude that I kind of even just was laughing to myself, thinking, yeah, no one's going to ever play this. I'll just do it like a you know, DIY digital album, put it on Bandcamp or whatever. So it's kind of almost like, I don't want to say taking the piss, but like just allowing just pure emotion and intensity to come out. But by the time I'd finished that song and then began probably the second track, which is Formless, from the album, that was when I started to realize, okay, I'm going to go balls out on the whole, Dead Guy Coalesce botch thing. Cause I love those bands to bits. They're every much as important to me as my good friends and mentors Clutch and the influence that they've had on me. And, I can't play anything that isn't stemming from a genuine, authentic place within me,
Yeah, I think, the bands that you've mentioned there, that is one thing that they all have in common, isn't it? It comes from a genuine place. There's no trying to build a certain sound. It's just that's who they are, which is the best way, if you ask me. you've alluded to some of the themes there and talked about, the emotion that you were going with and putting the emotion into it. I believe when we were talking, you mentioned, there was quite some themes of depression and mental health stuff on there, but also healing and spirituality as well. Was that something that was it kind of a cathartic exercise for you, given the environment the album was being built in with lockdown, or were those themes that you wanted to touch on?
It's, I kind of had no choice, really. But, as you just said, when you go through prolonged intense deep depression along with certain instances of trauma and whatnot, due to some rather large challenges I had to deal with in my personal life, it takes you there. And this is what annihilation really means, and this is what the album title means: self-induced transcendental annihilation. You go to your lowest point and then you fucking get torn apart by it, and then you start again. You start from zero. Some people call it a nervous breakdown. I call it spiritual awakening. And it is fucking crazy when you're going through it. But it's also a really beautiful thing. It's a very tough journey. And I'm kind of like 7 years out of the other side of it now, and it's been incredible, but it's been brutal as well, So I had no choice but to put all of that into this album. Like, I wasn't about to start writing some vanilla vacuous bullshit as a from where this came from, if you see what I mean.
Yeah. I mean, is there a hope for you that people going through that process, because like you say, when you hit that bottom, it is like there's no way out. You don't see, you can't see at that point that there is going to be a rebuilding and stuff like that. But once you've been through it, as you say, there's that revelation of what actually has happened there. So do you hope that people will be able to take that from the album when they listen to it?
I hope so, yeah. I really, I've tried to instill a rebuilding energy. It's not just a crybaby, woe is me kind of vibe. Certainly isn't that. I'd like to feel that this is a very empowering, motivational album. And as you just said, the only way is through. And it's layer after layer, layer by layer, spiral by spiral. That's the only way through. And if anyone watching this or listening to this is at their lowest point, all I can say is just keep going. And you are stronger than you even could possibly imagine. So just keep pushing through it. And it can be very lonely, because one thing I learned during my process was, you know who your real friends are. You find out who your real friends are. You find out who your enemies are too, I know what it's like to be kicked when down, put it that way. So, but it's beautiful. I wouldn't change it for the world. And I'm so grateful for all of it. I don't view any of it as bad. nor good. It just is what it is.
Yeah. And like you say, you know, sometimes you get to a point in life that that is needed, tearing it all up and starting again, you know, and not just in life, in all aspects of things that we do. Sometimes that just taking it right back, stripping it all back and having that chance to build afresh is the most positive journey that people can go through sometimes, though it very much doesn't feel like it when you're there, as we've said. No, it was in the terms of the spirituality side to it, and that, is that something that you came to as a result of going through this process, or has that always kind of been there for you?
Yeah, I mean, it smashed me around the head. I wasn't looking for anything. It's just that, you know, when you get to that lowest point, and then when you annihilate and then start again, it's at that point where you realize that, you know, it comes to you. Yeah, I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's the kind of thing that, you know, people turn somewhere, don't they, at some point, whether that's religion, spirituality, you know, friends, self-help, whatever you want to call it. Everybody finds something, don't they? For you, what's, I suppose, you know, an interesting question that I've just thought about is, what's the difference between you of maybe someone that finds religion as to someone that finds spirituality? Did you flirt with religion at all as part of finding that spirituality, or?
No, I view that. I view religion as being more of a man-made construct or an ideology or something that ultimately is designed to control and separate us. Whereas spirituality is, it's like the energetic core of everything, really, in my view. I also see how it ties in with metaphysics, quantum physics. It's energetic, ultimately. That's how I see it.
Well, it's interesting you pull those things together in one sentence, really, spirituality and then quantum physics and things like that, because when I think about, you know, the sound of this record, though you didn't build it in a technical way, it's about feel and stuff like that, there is a slight technical sound to it as well as spiritual. So that almost you've got that, the spirituality there, and then the you know, something very scientific's not the right word, I'm finding to pick the wrong word, but those two kind of concepts, you know, they come from separate areas but join together quite nicely, and that's a metaphor for this album in some respects.
Yeah, exactly. I mean if you're talking about maybe the kind of what I would call the complexity within my music, because I don't consider myself to be a technical musician. I kind of don't know really what the fuck I'm doing in many ways, because it's all feel and intuition and, you know, the core influences of, like, I've, you know, listed earlier. So, you know, I get off put by just tech dudes, tech musicians, session musicians. That kind of approach is completely not what I'm about.
Blast beats and click tracks and all that kind of thing. And
yeah, I mean, sometimes a click track is useful for certain applications, but when a band is just completely based off of, I mean, you know, it's more about it's about what's coming from the heart, ultimately, in all of this. And I think a lot of tech type musicians are just, I don't know, it just seems to be coming from the brain only. But, you know, anyway, going back to kind of like the process for me, it's, of course, there's technical application in terms of learning and feeling my way through how to construct the tracks, construct the demos, and then figure out how to play along and practice the live drums, as I said earlier. But the foundation, you know, creatively, the foundation of it is very much from the heart, very much from feel, intuition, and from energy.
Switching up slightly, you put this album together completely on your own. You know, it's a solo record, as you said. It's all about your feel, the process you've been through, the things you've been through in your life. Why put a band together at all on the back of that?
Actually, it happened, again, it happened really organically, because a friend of mine put my live drummer and friend Adam in touch with me. He just, you know, and then said, mutual friend, said, "Yo, I've just told Adam about what you're doing. He's going to get in touch with you." And I was like, okay. Well, I was not really, fully necessarily on board with that at that time. But Adam also works at the rehearsal room where I was doing all my drum practice, and continue to do all my drum practice. And we just struck up a good dialogue, and he ended up being really supportive to me, and which then fed into the more kind of accountability for me to continue smashing through self-imposed deadline after self-imposed deadline, and to complete the album. So it's been really, really great in that sense. And then as for Ross, my live bassist and friend, he's an old Swansea scene friend. We used to play shows together back in the day, and he's a Brazilian jiu-jitsu badass as well, and he hadn't played for many years, so I actually tattooed him, and the conversation stemmed from there. The day I tattooed him, I did him a Converge tattoo actually, and
nice.
It all came from there really, so very organic. A lot of synchronicity at play, which is something that has come into my life during my journey of the last few years.
Yeah, and things have a way of working out that way, don't they? You know, it's quite interesting how many times it's a bit of serendipity that leads you down a certain path.
Absolutely.
But you obviously had. Sorry, go on.
No, yeah, it's the best way I feel, and allowing rather than forcing, and in previous band experiences, I realized there was just too much forcing. And you know what they say, if you try and force the wrong shaped thing into a different shaped hole, it's just not, it's going to break or whatever the saying is, but you know.
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. Was there any, you know, cause you said you'd had no idea, you know, no plan to really put this out there as a proper album, let alone start touring it. Did you have reservations at all of going down that road? You said about having to put a lot of trust into the people that you brought on board. So yeah, did you have any second thoughts about going out on the road of it?
Kind of. I mean, you know, in a way, the first few band practices, it was like, well, let's just see how it goes. I was clear with the guys. It's like, well, let's just try it. We may not enjoy it, you know. So there's no, in that sense, there's no pressure. I mean, even if we stopped enjoying it tomorrow, I'd be fine with that, because I also know what it's like to be stuck in a band situation where you're ultimately really not having a good time and it just feels wrong, but you can't quite put your finger on why at, you know, when you're in it at that time. So yeah, hindsight's a wonderful thing.
It is indeed. And we're going to talk now a little bit about you, Jimbob, because as I said at the beginning of the interview, you've got lots of fingers in lots of pies and doing lots of things. The main things being, you know, a graphic artist, tattoo artist and musician. What came first for you, art or music?
That's a good one. I mean, when I was like a, you know, before I was barely walking, I remember that my mum has told me she would put me on the kitchen floor and I would bang pots and pans. And then, yeah, so I would say that in a weird way, drumming came to me first in that sense.
Okay.
And started, yeah, I started playing acoustic, well, with an acoustic guitar then when I was 11. Only had lessons for like a year and a half, and then got bored, and then just taught myself rock and metal by ear onwards from that point. And then, but yeah, I was always drawing and filling up sketchbooks and copying comic books and stuff from, you know, from a pretty young age, like five, six, seven. And I remember, like, I allowed drawing to completely leave my life once I got to college and I took the digital design route. And but luckily, you know, I've always maintained that digital side of things as well, whether it's, you know, digitally coloring some of my illustrations or doing a lot of the video work and editing work. So, for example, the Silverburn Formless video, I completely did all the CGI compositing and editing for that. So that was another big learning element. My video work prior to that was a bit more limited. Myself and Adam and Ross, my bandmates, we shot it together against green screen in the studio, and I did all the rest. So super happy with being able to expand my knowledge and practice in that area.
That's a huge skill to pick up, you know, that it's massive.
Yeah, I love it. And we're going to do a full band video soon, and I'm going to try and, you know, improve and expand on various aspects of that as well. So yeah, you know, I started drawing and illustrating properly around 2010 or 11. Very glad to say my first client was Clutch, and those gentlemen have been so endlessly kind to me. It's been an incredible journey with them.
Just on that point, because as you know, a lot of Clutch fans listen to my show. I mean, how did that relationship kick off? You know, they were, you say they were your first client in that respect, but how did you get that relationship with the guys?
Well, I first saw Clutch opening for Biohazard in 1993 in Cardiff Bogies Club. I was 16, so do the math, then you'll figure out what age I am. But but yeah, that was life-changing. Clutch made me realize I could start a band without necessarily being a technical thrash whatever player, kind of, you know, tying into what I said earlier. So Clutch really, really did start it off for me in terms of actually starting to do it myself. And then, so Tame, you know, my first and long-running band, we covered Impetus. We did it as a secret track on our Die Die Truth Speaker mini CD, which is actually an album. It's not so mini, but that's what it was marketed as by the DIY record label at the time. Right. But so through that cover of Impetus, that is what got me to contact the band. And lo and behold, Neil Fallon replied to me at the time, which blew my mind, because this was like early kind of email internet days. There was no social media whatsoever. I was still doing the whole tape. Well, I was only a couple of years I were out of having done the whole tape trading DIY thing. So, I come from that. So it all stemmed from there. And it was just a very gradual friendship that grew and grew. And then Taint ended up opening for Clutch a few times. And then we went on a couple of tours with them. And they continued that through to Hark. So Hark toured with them once or twice. And yeah, I consider them as mentors, older brothers, and great friends, authentic friends, which sometimes in this industry, you don't tend to necessarily have fully authentic friendships. You know what I mean? Sometimes it can be a bit superficial and whatnot.
Yeah. I mean, you can tell over the years how close it's been, you know, how many times you've worked with them, and, you know, when they came through in Wales recently, you know, you played on stage with them at Cardiff. So that's amazing. I mean, let's be clear, that above my head is a piece of your artwork that you did for Clutch, for those that aren't aware. You mentioned there that the Clutch were a bit of a game changer for you, you know, showing you that you didn't need to be someone really technical to put a band together. But what other bands kind of influenced you in those early periods of picking up an instrument?
Oh yeah, it was like, you know, Quicksand, Helmet, Sepultura, Biohazard, you know. There was always that hardcore element for me, you know, and I think a lot of people these days might miss the hardcore lineage that Clutch even has, you know. They come from the Washington DC scene, and they would be watching, you know, doom metal one night and then Fugazi and Bad Brains the next night. So there's always going to be that mixture. And I kind of feel like a lot of more current, the whole kind of stoner rock movement, the way that it's gone, has actually in some ways lost a little bit of that kind of punk edge. You know, it's like, in that sense, bands like Fu Manchu, you know, they come from a hardcore scene, really, you know. So
it is interesting that you say that. It's interesting that you touch on that, because I've been thinking that it's become a little bit self-recycling, really, the scene, in some respects. It, like I say, it's being influenced by, it's that being around that long now, stoner rock bands now are being inspired by other stoner rock bands. But even go back to Caius, so Jetson and those early bands, there was a punk and DIY influence there as well, wasn't it? The Obsessed were,
absolutely,
you know, Washington DC, right in the middle of all of that.
Absolutely.
So it's interesting that you pick up on that.
Yeah, I was listening to the last Obsessed album yesterday, in fact, and it's, you know, it's fantastic, and it's their real deal, of course, it's Wino, but the song structure, the energy, the attitude, it's punk, you know. St. Vitus used to play shows with Black Flag. You've got the whole SST Records thing. I'm just hearing a lot of, like, sanitized, kind of like fifth generational AI, almost, as a way that I recently kind of put it, but, you know, each to their own, but, like, it doesn't speak to me. And, you know, I guess I got really tired of being tagged with the stoner term, stoner metal this, stoner blah, blah, blah. Ironically, I was a huge stoner, by the way. which, you know, that's another funny kind of duality to my own journey. But, yeah, hope all of that makes sense anyway.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And, you know, like you say, it's, you know, different things for different people, you know, and bands approach it in different ways. It comes down to personal taste. But I just thought it was an interesting observation, and you know, where the scene started to where it's got to now, it is, as you say, two completely different places, whether you see that as bad or good, really. Keeping on with some of your influences and stuff like that, moving on to, you know, particularly the drums, and when you're learning some of these other instruments that you were looking at. I mean, the drums, you suggested there was already an interest and already some kind of ability there.
Yeah.
Who did you turn to in terms of influences when learning those new instruments?
I mean, yeah, I was always, I mean, drums are not new to me. I mean, the first tour I ever did was actually filling in for the Dukes of Nothing around 2002, 2003. That was with the guys from Iron Monkey and Acrimony and Orange Goblin. Chris Turner couldn't make the tour, so I filled in last minute. We did 2 weeks in Europe with Spirit Caravan, speaking of Wino. And that was like a, you know, trial by fire, amazing experience. So I've always been able to drum to a certain modest level. So it was just a case of really upping my game. But, you know, in terms of my actual drumming influence, you know, John Paul Gaster from Clutch, of course, John Stanier from Helmet, Danny Schuler from Biohazard, and then some more unsung people, especially somebody who's been on my mind a lot recently, Andrew Gormley from Kiss It Goodbye, which is the band that followed Dead Guy when Dead Guy initially broke up. Andrew Gormley's drumming and ideas on the Kiss It Goodbye album are just mind-blowingly good. He drummed in another band called Space Boy, I think he did. Space Boy is another band which for me would be influential up there with Botch and Mastodon, for example, in terms of like weird, complex rather than technical, I would say. But you know, and then you've got, I guess, more kind of more contemporary drummers like Eloy Casagrande from Sepultura again, and even, I mean, I'm not exactly an Animals as Leaders fan at all musically, really, but Matt Gutzka from that band is crazy good as well. So, and then obviously Brandala from Mastodon. So but really, my core influences are going to be, there's always going to be John Paul and Danny from Biohazard, and even, you know, someone like Mackie from the Cro-Mags.
Okay, yeah.
Tons of flavor and groove and identity, and you can, you know, it's like JP always taught me, like he would always look for someone who's got an identity, not just being technically good. And I completely agree, and I never forgot him saying that to me. And that's how I feel. You know, to me, this is art. This is not technical fret exercise or chops. It's like, chops are important, of course, but then music to me shouldn't really start to become like sports, you know, like sport competition, if you see what I mean.
No, absolutely, yeah. And when you think about, you know, the drummers that people talk about as the greats, you know, certainly in the rock circles and stuff like that, you know, you people like your John Bonham and your Keith Moon, it was all about feel with them, you know, and all
exactly.
You know, that side of stuff. And I think the best drummers always do stand out in that way for their personality. You feel the personality through the music, don't you?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know, I think in the Silverburn record, you're going to hear that kind of a combination of moments that are really on point and you know, coming from the kind of Ego Cavalera influence. But then you'll hear big open grooves and swing coming from the John Stanier and John Paul Gaster influence. Ooh. So that's my, and you know, the material on this album was all really written initially from drumming patterns and ideas that I'll beatbox it into my phone, and then I'll use that to then help me tap in the organic digital drum tracks, and you know, so it's all coming from intuition and groove and feel and swing, and then again, you know, training myself with some of the more kind of on point moments.
I mean, that's the key with drumming, isn't it? Is hitting those key moments, and the rest in between is you know, is all about the feel, and the swing is the perfect point there that you just said, I think. Last question for you, and I will have to go, I'm afraid, Jim, but my boss just tried calling me.
Yeah, cool.
So I just thought, switching back to the art now. This is a question that I've asked musicians a lot about their album artwork, you know, in terms of their commissioning process and how they hand things over to an artist. But as a graphic artist yourself, when you get a commission, you know, you're trying to balance, I suppose, your own style that you have as an artist, the band style and the graphics and the branding they might already have, for a lack of a better term, but then also the music and what that's saying to you. What's your process for that? How do you blend all of that together?
Yeah, you've hit the nail on the head. It's just like a huge melting pot. And, you know, fundamentally my illustration influences, again, it's like music. You have core influences. I've got core illustration influences, you know, certainly stemming from Alphonse Mucha, the Art Nouveau master, you know, from way back. I was like 16 when I first fell in love with Mucha. And then bringing it into the more contemporary setting with, you know, good friend Richie Beckett or the German maestro Florian Bertmer. I mean, there's so many. It's, you know, I see it as being like, you know, it's like being in a thrash metal band or a hardcore band, or, you know, there's many different bands of that style, you know, sharing their own interpretation of that genre. And for me, I consider my artwork the same thing. So every, you know, the way my art has progressed, I feel like I'm constantly paying tribute to those core influences, much like with the Silverburn record, I'm paying tribute to those core musical influences.
And then, so when you bring that in, you know, if the band gives you a brief, you know, that they want and that, where do you start with that? Do you then go and listen to the record next, try and match that up with a brief, then bring your own feel into that and interpretation? What's the kind of order that you go through?
It's kind of like it's like all of it at the once at the same time. That sounds like that recent movie title. Everything, you know, whatever that movie
is. Everything Everywhere All at Once, yeah.
That's the guy, that's the one. It's like that. It's kind of meditative in that sense when you receive a brief and you sit there with it and you feel into it and all of those different factors as you've described, you're kind of like allowing all of it to kind of like stew within your consciousness and you just start to like pull things out from it and whatnot. Hope that makes sense.
Yeah. Have you ever had a brief that when you've then listened to the music doesn't fit the music that you're hearing? Maybe the band have just artistically got a different idea for the artwork?
Yeah, that's very rare. Yeah. You know, I'm lucky that people, they usually let me run with everything and Yeah, there's a bit of back and forth, but it's rare that something just doesn't work, you know.
Jimbob, it's been fascinating catching up with you again. You know, it's been a really interesting chat, and I thank you for joining me for a rerun of what should have been
Yeah.
a Mark Tangent interview.
Yeah, it's been great. No, thank you for some really great questions and the detail, and thanks for being open to hearing what I've had to say about everything, and I really appreciate it.